So about this whole season is difficult books and heavy topics, but this one in particular is of a special difficulty.
Yeah, graphic content to come regarding sexual assault.
Yes. So if that makes you uncomfortable, feel free to skip this episode. Come back in 2 weeks for Duck's Newbery Report. But if you want to, if you read along, it's a fantastic book, worth reading no matter who you are. We've already recorded the episode. We want to do this after the fact because we're like, oh, things get heavy. So if you want to skip, go ahead. But we hope you stick around if you feel up to it. But without further ado, here's Any Man.
Ho ho!
Hello and welcome to How to Win the Lottery, Episode 7, Any Man by Amber Tamblyn, Ambitams. I'm Joey Lewandowski.
I'm Bobby Fischer. Why did you say the Ambitams? Is that
it's
a thing?
It's what my sister calls her. I don't know if it's a common name. I don't know if it's an uncommon name. I like it. I mean, her name has internal rhyme. Amber Tam.
I guess so, yeah.
It's not like, it's not assonance or consonants. It's just whatever the third thing is. Just amb.
It's a third thing.
Amber is, I'm not going to say that. Color of her energy.
Yeah, don't do that. That's a hack.
Oh, sorry.
Hack.
It's episode 7. This is the final episode before our 1,000-pager Duck's Newbery Port, which is going to be out in 2 weeks for you, but will be like a month for us because we need time to read that big old book. But here we go. A book that is short, heavy, but also quick to read because it's basically written sort of poetry style.
How short was it? You read, I listened to the audiobook of this. You read the Kindle?
So I read the Kindle. The Kindle is like 280 pages, but there's a lot of pages that are like one line.
Yeah, and there's also a large section made up of tweets. Yep. There's a large section that is the guy repeating the single word or mm-hmm. the single phrase over yep. and over and over again.
I think this would actually be one a fascinating one to own physically because sure. it does feel I get the sense, I don't think I was shortchanged in reading it on Kindle, but I think it's one more so than most other books that we've read, if not all of the books we've read so far this season, that like actually being able to thumb through it would be like, oh, this is like, there was intent in how it was written.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that there is also intent in the assemblage of the audiobook, which I think functions kind of, less like literature and more like a play. You have different actors and for different characters, you have different people doing the voices. But then also one thing that in the audiobook I think was very specifically came across was the TV show that was similar to The View, where there's a lot of people talking over each other and laughing over each other. And so when those people are interacting, you really get the sense of, in that section, almost a palpable joy that they're having in discussing this thing because they're all laughing and joking about it. And it's like the juxtaposition of that with the actual subject matter is horrendous in a way that is intentional, obviously, but it also like when you hear it, it makes you rethink the way that this stuff plays out horrendously in real life as well.
Well, what is that subject matter? What is Any Man about?
Okay, so Any Man is a largely epistolary novel, right?
Which means what?
Epistolary is a novel made up of documents.
Okay, yeah.
So in this case, you have tweets, emails, transcripts of radio shows. There are sections that are straight up prose, that mm-hmm. are the direct thoughts. So it's not entirely an epistolary novel. But like other famous epistolary novels, like Dracula is an epistolary novel, for example. But it's an epistolary novel that is about a female serial rapist, largely told from the point of view of her victims.
And she's referred to about halfway through to the end as Maud. It's unclear if she exists or doesn't. That's also kind of not the point.
Whoa. What do you mean it's unclear if she exists or doesn't?
Well, there's like mythology built around her of like 6 feet long white hairs and stuff.
Oh.
Like she, I'm not saying that they made it up, but I'm just saying that like there is a fantastical element to this. Because I think at its core, this is such a simple story that it's remarkable that I haven't seen. Because the point, I think, a point that Amber Tamblyn is trying to make is that so many women report rapes and are not believed, or they don't report the rape, or it's so commonplace and it shouldn't be. And then here you get the inverse, and I feel like it's such a simple idea to inverse the genders and to have men be the victim.
Yeah.
And it's so effective because they're even in that section with the tweets, like there are people like talking about like a woman getting raped or whatever, and it has like one like or whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
And like that's very effective too, because it's like that still exists. We're just not talking about it. But like these four it's dudes old or whatever. Yes,
it is. Women get raped, and we know that.
Yes,
and that's just part. We've accepted societally. We've accepted that as what the price of being a woman or something like that. And so what Amber Tamblyn is doing is she's saying that all of the questions and the absurdities that we see the men, the male victims bump up against in their struggle for justice here are ones that women actually face every day. But because we've internalized those struggles, every day they seem normal. But when you inverse the genders, it plays like an absurd comedy.
Right.
Which makes probably the male audience uncomfortable. It's a book probably meant to be read by men.
Yeah.
I think women reading this book probably will be like, I get it. I don't necessarily need it.
Right. And I think that's why it's so simple that I was surprised. And I don't mean simple in any pejorative way. I just think that like it's such an effective way to get this through to a new audience in theory.
Yeah.
But again, not to judge one way or the other, but I feel like men who are reading books, especially books like this, don't necessarily need to know that this is a problem. I mean, maybe they're...
It can't hurt. I still think that I got a lot of value out of this book, but...
I also think this book is incredible.
No, you're right that in that the people who would most benefit from hearing this are not going to pick this book up.
Right.
Which is like a major tragedy in all of literature, I think. It's like the people that the message is meant for are just never going to receive it.
Right.
Blech.
But I think that, you know, that you can do it in other ways, like what Emerald Fennell did with Promising Young Woman. It's like, this is like kind of like a slasher.
Yeah.
It's not the same thing, but it's trying, I think, to cross that gap and approach about the topic of sexual assault and rape and stuff. And
yeah.
Get it to a new group of people that like, oh, I want to see Carey Mulligan in the neon soaked whatever. It's just like, oh no, this is like actually a heavy thing. So
yeah, you and I have a gap in our opinions of that film.
But I think that this book is remarkable both in how it's written, in the point of view that it takes, in the actual physical style of it. I didn't know so Amber Tamblyn, obviously an actress, a performer, but started as a published author as a poet?
Is a poet, yeah. Okay. Is a poet before this. And it's very, like, very much a poet's novel, right? It's a novel that sort of savors language. One of the main characters, one of the victims of rape, is a poet himself. So she kind of gets away with using that language because it's like, this guy's a poet. This is how he thinks. That's actually the part that I had the most problem with in the book, was that I thought that the language being as flowery as it is in certain sections and as like manipulative of poetic constructs and stylistic choices walked me a little bit away from the verisimilitude of like the bluntness of the subject matter. And that's not a real complaint. That's like an aesthetic difference of opinion between me and the author.
Sure. Because I think what is... Like, I don't know that I agree or disagree with that. I think that's a valid opinion. But what I do like, and what I think is important and effective, and she does a good job of it, is that there's like four or five main victims, right? And they each have like a kind of like a distinctly different style.
Yes.
And there's one where it's just like kind of like a young dude. There's one who's like kind of like a washed up comedian who's like in the 60s who seems based on, to a certain extent, Marc Maron.
Who's voiced by Marc Maron.
There's the poet. There's like this guy who becomes, or maybe this is one of the guys I've already mentioned, but like one becomes this like, you know, Sirius XM radio DJ or whatever. And like they all have like different trajectories.
One who seems kind of based on Milo Yiannopoulos, maybe.
Yeah.
That section in particular, I found really interesting because I know very little politically about Amber Tamblyn, but I think we go into things like this, poets, novelists, etc., assuming a progressive political stance, and the subject matter certainly, I think, in this case is politically progressive. And she presents this character who is a right-wing shock author, right? Someone who's like...
So I think he even describes himself as a gay libertarian who hates feminists, right?
Yeah, like someone who's very much trying to
offend
and like is a a morph of many actual people that we see in society, whether they be regular people on Twitter or celebrities like Milo Yiannopoulos or someone like Tucker Carlson, who's not gay, but, you know, you get the point. And I think that something that is fascinating about what Tamblyn does here is she presents him accurately, but also empathetically, right? Yeah. When we read his story, and especially when he calls in at the end calls in the radio station and talks about the person who was the person in prison who called. He's a human being, and he becomes this person that we're not meant to dismiss him because of his political opinions or because we don't like who he is. He's presented in a way that we're very much not supposed to like who he is. But when this horrific thing happens to him, we and he responds in a way by saying like, "Oh, these other people it's very brave of him to call in," and we respond to him as a human being who deserves dignity and who deserves bodily autonomy and deserves to not be violated, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Like, that's a political choice that she makes in the book. And I think it's a good one because I think a lot of times we dismiss victims of things because we don't like who they are rather than we might hate the thing that's happening to them, but we can forgive the thing that's happening to them because we don't like who they are.
Right.
So I think the book is careful about saying like, that's a bad idea because you have to dismiss, you have to hate the thing, right? Like in a very like Christy way, hate the sin, not the sinner. I'm losing.
Hate the player, not the game.
I'm losing, going off the rails here.
No, but I think it's almost like everyone is a person and we should listen to all stories and remember the fact that like, their life is irrevocably altered.
Yeah.
Either in small ways or big ways. And I think that's also something that, like, one of these dudes develops, like, a horrific eating disorder where he can't eat anything with skin or that gets unpeeled. And by the end of his section is, like, only eating tablespoons of mustard and drinking water.
And cutting himself so that he can get the poison out.
Yeah. Like, and it's just, like, that's one of the more extreme, but it's, you know.
It's a very content warning book.
Okay.
Right? Like going into it beforehand, you should be like, there's we should probably record
a little thing to put before this that'd be like, hey, this is kind of a, you know, because this whole season is heavy, but this is especially like.
Yeah.
One thing that we were talking about, because we're now, I mentioned the next book, Ducks Newbury Port's over 1,000 pages, but that also, like this, feels very modern because it is modern. Like we've read other new books this season, but like Pizza Girl was set like 20 years ago or whatever, 10 years ago, and Death on Her Hands, it sort of is out of time by design, it seems. But
the Curtis White book is pretty aesthetically forward thinking. Like that's pushing the boundaries of how we tell stories and things like that.
But like this and the next book we're going to talk about in a couple weeks both feel like they are of this era. And I think I'll just stick to this one, like, does it really well. And like you mentioned before, like the tweet section, like I think you're able to especially have empathy for like a Milo type character because you actually literally have President of the United States Donald J. Trump tweeting in this book, "Don't worry, we are working with Greatest to catch Monster Maud. Disgusting. America has best, most amazing experts." Like, she can, like, dunk on the people that you already, like, instead of, like, directing your rage toward Milo, you're directing your rage towards someone that you know is real that you don't like or whatever.
Well, I'm also wondering, who are some of the other real people in that Twitter section? Do you remember?
Oh, it's a lot. There's a lot of, like Katy Perry and stuff, and, like, Keith Olbermann, I think. Because that section is one of the most fascinating things to me because it's blending. It's showing the evolution.
Yeah.
And it's like there's comedians joking about it and people using the hashtag.
Daniel Tosh is one of them.
And then there's also just like, you know, normal people and just, you know, not getting any interaction.
I'm wondering how you feel about that ethically. Like the idea of like putting opinions about male rape victims in the mouths of real celebrities that she's probably she's assuming those opinions based on longstanding political opinions that they've had and the way that they've interacted in
public. And I think before, they're all
they feel right, they feel accurate
because it's fair use and it's criticism and it's
satire in a way.
Right, so like Donald Trump can't be like, I can't believe, but like Trump does not necessarily come off
he's not saying anything bad.
He just looks like a buffoon because we're ascribing that whatever to him. So
That's interesting. So it's like it's neither show nor tell because it's like using the context that we have outside of the book to ascribe motive behind a thing.
Well, it's like how, and it's not this exact thing, but you had me read that Tao Lin book where it's like Dakota Fanning.
Yeah.
And who's the other, who's that male actor in that?
Haley Joel Osment.
And it's just like, it's not them, but like,
yeah.
I think they have more of a reason to be upset.
Yeah.
It's just like these two like underage kids like stealing things and doing drugs and whatever. And just like, but every time they're referred to as Haley Joel Osment and Dakota Fanning. And, uh-huh. and even when they're like, instead of saying the word he, it says Haley Joel Osment like every single time.
Yeah.
And that feels more like, I mean, that's also satire or whatever Talon's doing. I don't know. But like that feels more grounds for being upset than like you wrote a fake tweet. And, like, it only had 786,000 comments of 1.6 million retweets. Like, that would have had at least 3 million. It's like, what do you...
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's things like that, and a lot of this book, genuinely, and, like, another similar thing is, like, she does, like, a kind of, a, like, a play-by-play breakdown of a dude on his web browser, going from, like, OkCupid to, like, MLB.com to Grubhub to, like, Pornhub to Facebook and whatever, and it feels... Like, I don't know, in 5 years, I might feel dated, I don't know, but, like, it feels still, even a couple years after this comes out... That's how people operate. And, like, him, like, leaving shitty, snarky comments on MLB.com, like, refresh, refresh, refresh. Just, like, fucking, like, come on, guys. Like, just needling.
Yeah.
Like, it just feels of this time and so real. And even when it's not, like, covering the... I don't want to say, like, the Me Too element or just, like, the sexual assault element. It just feels it embodies this era overall in a way that, like... few other books I've read have done.
Well, I think it does an interesting thing in capturing something that maybe we're all going through or have been all going through. I don't want to say that what we're all going through is similar to rape because those sort of comparisons are kind of odious. But like it does a good job of taking like crushing mundanity, right? The like that web browsing section and juxtaposing it with absolute physical horror.
Yeah.
So I think that's like what we large scale have been dealing with for quite a long time, where we'll spend hours on MLB.com or Twitter or whatever and just like you know, scrolling through Tinder, like left, 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 right, right, left, 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 without even like considering that these are human beings, or doing any number of things that just like eats up hours and hours and hours of the day.
Yeah.
Like mobile web browser games of like Brick Blast or McMansion Match Mansion or whatever it is.
In case you're wondering what Bob does when he's not recording podcasts or reading books, he's playing
lots of Brick and Balls.
McMansion Match.
Lots of Brick and Balls. And lots of those games, but which now that I think about it, might be why my wrist hurts all the time.
If you
that's a callback, baby.
You get to a Patreon exclusive episode. Go to patreon.com/lotterypod to find out about Bob's wrist pain and the very thoughtful gift that our friend gave him.
didn't give it to me. He sent me a picture.
Oh, I thought he bought it. Okay.
No.
Oh,
well. It's this juxtaposition of that kind of mundanity, which is in itself crushing, but then also like truly horrific things like children in cages and
yeah.
Drone strikes and unarmed people being killed by police and protesters being crushed by authoritarian, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So like it's not necessarily rape, although that is also a part of because like juxtaposed with this mundanity is the news every week, every other week of some new person getting Me Too'd. And then you realize, which probably most women have always known, but you realize like the sheer numbers of that stuff and how like, and just to like consider all of those things together really feels like a 21st century novel in a way that like, other books don't necessarily.
Yeah.
She's capturing it.
And I think another thing that she does that, you know, I like to think of myself as empathetic and understanding, but also I have not been in this position. Like, sure. I have not been sexually assaulted and I don't, you know, but there's like things that she does in here that like, even, you know, I don't know how to say what I want to say. Like, I don't know that like I needed to be told this. I understand this, but I still learn from this because like there's things like where the dad is talking to his son.
Oh yeah.
Because his son is like, they were saying at school that you were raped and I don't know what that word means. And it's just like the ripple effects of like, not only is this guy, like the book opens with this guy outside of a bar, bloody, like in a pool of his own blood. And what we later find out was that this woman, Maud, like grinded on him through his jeans to the point where like his genitals just like dissolve, like they just like ground down basically. Right. And he's just like, his masculinity has been removed in more ways than one. And you know, he goes to the hospital and comes home and, like, his life is changed, but he's driving his son to school or picking his son up from school or whatever. And his son's like, they were saying at school that, like, you were raped, and I don't know what that word means. Like, are you okay? Like, that sounds like, I don't mind anybody would ever do that. And yeah. It's like things like that where it's like, not only does it impact you, but it impacts your son and also, like, his friends talking about it. Because, like, this guy's national news now.
Well, also, I found that particular section of the kid, of him talking with his son, to be maybe, I think, the best part of the whole book. Because it displays almost a thesis statement in that the kid keeps asking him questions.
Yep.
Right? The kid says, well, why this? Why this? Why this? And the questions that the kid is repeating are questions that are often put in the mouths of defense attorneys, prosecutors, right? People who are trying to I guess more defense attorneys than prosecutors, because they're asking those questions of the victims. Well, why were you out drinking without your wife? Why were you doing this? Why were you doing that? When she puts those questions in the voice of a child, you realize how fucking childish those questions are, right? I mean, yeah. So and so, like, the entire way that we approach this is moronic, societally moronic.
And I think what's also, like, what struck me about that, because I think I got some of that, but I don't think I got it to that extent. But I also think what struck me, it's not a, I mean, I don't know. I don't have kids, so maybe it is. But it feels like that's not a conversation that people are having with little boys. Like, I can imagine,
yeah, that's a good point,
I can imagine moms, even if they have not been sexually assaulted, like, having to have a conversation with a girl, like, don't put yourself in this position. Like, nothing you did wrong. Like, it's not how you dress, whatever. But, like, there are just, like, people out there who want to hurt you. And I think just having it be a father to his son, because it's not like a mom telling a son. I mean, again, I don't have the context. It could be. Maybe, I'm sure good parents are having this conversation, right? But, like, not talking to little boys, dad's not giving that kind of talk. It feels like something that, like, a mom would tell her daughter, even without it having happened to them.
But it's something that would plausibly never even occur to a father to have that conversation with his son.
Correct.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, again, this is like 30 years ago, but there was a Michael Douglas movie where he gets raped and people think it's a joke. Like, how can a man get raped? It's like, well, yeah.
What movie is
Disclosure,
that?
I think.
Never seen it.
Maybe not Disclosure.
But, I mean, you can't, there's no, like, I mean, the like, ubiquity of prison rape jokes in movies is like, over male rape is a,
but even, like, they
hilarious,
make, they
right?
make jokes, like, she writes jokes in here that are not funny, but, like, people are like, well, like, don't you need, like, an erection to get, like, and if you have an erection, like, aren't you aroused? It's like, well, that's not the point.
Well, that's what the made to penetrate thing is, right? Which becomes mod to penetrate, which becomes, like, a pun, which is a kind of joke, which shows how not seriously we're taking it.
Yep.
Let's talk about, like, the quote, supernatural element to it, if there is a supernatural element to it.
Well, so there's Jamar, right, who is, like, the youngest victim, and he's the one who, like, meets Maude on OkCupid.
Which is the only link to who she actually is as a person, because her OkCupid profile still exists, and later on in the text she ends up communicating with the press through
Which OkCupid. Is insane. Like, the whole, like, the press stuff here, like, some of it was really effective to me, like, in, like, the news reporter. He's like, how did you, like, the first guy, he's like, how did you get my email? And she's like, oh, we called your son's school, and, like, they just gave you email. It's like, what the fuck? Like, like, that probably happens, but it's like that kind of vulturistic shit is blood-boiling.
Yeah.
Then this, like, there's, like, the section where just, like, a reporter's like, yeah, I work for this newspaper. Like, if you want to tell me your story, it's like, why would that ever, why would she ever respond? And then she does. So I'm like, that was where I was like, I'm not sure about this. Like, that's, like, sort of stretching my credulity too far. Like, that's the one thing, but...
Because there are ways in which she does feel like a wraith of sorts. Like you were saying, she has the single 6-foot-long string of white hair, which feels possible but unlikely.
Right.
She leaves zero evidence behind in any of these cases, even though the scenes are quite brutal.
Right.
And, like, biologically brutal.
And, like, there's the one where Jamar... is, like, she came over, she was wearing a mask, she came over at the stroke of midnight.
She's just wearing a wolf mask, right?
And, like, you know, they started, like, making it or whatever. And they may not make it because they're wearing masks or whatever. But, like, eventually she rapes him with a broomstick.
Trigger warning. She rapes him by having him penetrate a dead animal.
Right. Okay, yes. And then that's all that's left. Like, the only evidence is that there was, like, seminal fluid inside a cat or something.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't think that it was supernatural in the same way that we talked about last episode with Colorless Sukaroo, which is like, oh no, like, there may be, like, mind walking, like Stephen King. I don't know what that book is, but like, where like they're in dreams, dreamwalkers. I don't know, whatever. But maybe that's, I think that's probably a point where it's like, well, men can't get raped unless it was like actually like a demon who did it. I didn't think it was actually supernatural, but like there are like weird things here where she seems, again, not like above the law, but like that she won't be caught because she doesn't leave evidence, like you were saying. And there's like the evidence she does leave is like a 6 foot long white hair. It's like,
what? And also like she won't, she also won't be caught because it's like nobody cares, right? They care about it as sensationalistic. They care about it as a joke. They care about it as these other things. But ultimately, like, rape victims are dismissed. And,
yeah.
they're not, like, their cases aren't followed up on. But there's, you know, at the end he has that, he has the monologue on the radio where he talks about just the sheer number of rape kits that have gone untested. And yeah. that it's not even legally necessary in most states to test the rape kits. So, you know, I think her not getting caught and her existing in this space of appearing, disappearing. In reality, if you had an OkCupid account, it would be pretty easy to track who you were, I think,
oh, yeah.
ultimately. But she can't be caught because she's this boogeyman, boogeywoman.
Right. Well, because she's embodying an idea, right? Like, yeah. And I think that's the other thing, that it's not like the tens or hundreds of thousands or whatever of rapes that happen every year, month, week, day, whatever the horrific statistics are. It's like, this is like four dudes or whatever, right? Yeah. And so each of them's a high profile case. She's almost elevated, even if she's just like a normal person who like doesn't leave evidence, like she's elevated to like ghost like status or something because there's such interest in these things.
Well, the way that Richard Ramirez was, the way that Jeffrey Dahmer was,
yeah.
the way that we like give names, like they're supervillains to these serial killers. You know, they earn that status through the press, which is partially what they want from the press. And no matter how many psychologists say, look, don't do this, the press keeps doing it because it's capitalistically good for them. So, like, if something like this were happening in the actual world, I feel like it's very realistic the way that it plays out in this book. I was also thinking about the name Maud being given to her. I don't have that much to say about it other than that obviously Maud to penetrate becomes an easy pun
sure.
to make, but also Maud is not a terribly common name, but it is the name of B. Arthur, the B. Arthur sitcom that is like a seminal feminist sitcom. The titular character's name is Maud.
Sure. I was thinking it's like, you know, Harold and Maud.
Yeah. And
but
yeah.
it just feels like an old lady kind of name. Like, how would, again, not that this is the point, but like you can imagine someone being like, oh, how did you get raped? You're a dude. And also you got raped by a woman named Maud. Like, you couldn't overpower Maud.
Right. Yeah.
Or whatever. Yeah. I don't know if that's a point, but again, maybe the,
well, there, I think there's intent to the naming. I don't think it's a complete mistake.
Yeah. I feel like she's smart enough that she would have said, like, if it wasn't Maud, if it was some other name, there would have been a different pun that they, you know,
yeah.
took to Twitter with or whatever. Right. I want to talk about the Marin section because there's, it's this comedian. It feels like Marin. So Mark Marin is a comedian who also hosts the slightly more popular than our podcast. WTF with Mark Marin. And, you know, he was a comedian who was like, was making a living, but never really broke it big, and then had this podcast.
Started in Boston.
And then became this, like, you know, people know him. People who don't even listen to podcasts know him because, like, he interviewed Obama. And, like, it's just, like, he had a show on IFC for 4 or 5 years, whatever. And, like, he became a thing.
Yeah.
But this kind of feels like a character, like, if the podcast never took off, he's just still, like, a sort of, like, a struggling-ish comedian who's making a living. Like, he's a comic by trade.
He's an alcoholic.
Yes.
He's a very, like, one of those really angry guys.
Yeah. And I think his section is, I think this is where maybe listening would have, because I know the only other name that I recognized, because in the thank you, in the acknowledgments at the end, she also thanks her, like, I guess her dad, Russ Tamblyn, also read a section.
Yeah.
I don't know what character he played, but he also, you know, Dr. Jacoby from Twin Peaks.
Sure. And classic dancer from old-timey cinema.
Those videos on YouTube of him dancing are
yeah.
insane. And also, I'm sure the movies, he actually did those, and not just, they don't just exist on YouTube, like, wherever they were pulled
from.
Well,
he's in West Side Story and
yeah.
stuff, right?
But, like, I think knowing that it was Marin, being able to, like, physically picture, because I think, I don't know that there's, and maybe just because I haven't read it, I finished a couple days ago, I don't remember if there's a lot of physical detail of the victims, and I think there would almost be a reason not to, because it's like it could happen to literally the titular any man, right? Like, it just,
yeah, exactly, yeah.
But I think being able to be like, oh, this is Marin, like, I kind of connected with that more. And so him the way that he talks about the alcohol, but like he's like, I needed a little, I was feeling lonely, so I brought her home or whatever. And it sounds like he picked up a prostitute
sure,
and yeah, it's just a bottle of Jim Beam or whatever. It's like, mm-hmm. oh shit, like that was amazing. And then him, I think maybe that same night, like killing that tree.
Trying to kill himself, failing, and then
taking a chainsaw to a tree.
So he talks about how in the beginning of the novel, he talks about how if you're going to kill yourself, hang yourself from a tree, you have to have a relationship with that tree. And then later on, he admits to having tried to kill himself, but he describes the tree as being this sort of majestic tree that is sort of local legend. And he gets drunk and he tries to kill himself, and the branch snaps, even though the branch was strong enough to bear his weight. It's almost a miracle that he survived.
Right.
And so he goes home and he gets a chainsaw and he cuts into the tree, and the tree lives for a little while longer and then dies. Almost like he traded his life for the tree's
right.
life.
And I just think that was so, it was a really effective metaphor, I think, but also just, I think because I knew it was Marin, because you said something about like, oh yeah, Marin Reese was based on the character based on him.
It feels like it.
And I was like, oh, I haven't gotten there yet. And then like the next chapter is just like, yeah, like, you know, I'm a dude from Boston who went to Albuquerque or something, just, or whatever. It's like, yeah. It's Marin. Yeah, it's like, but
lock the gates. That's what he says over and over again.
But I do think, you know, on this topic, Amber Tamblyn married to David Cross, other sure. fellow Boston
comedian.
Yeah,
so she's part of the comedic scene.
Yes.
She's aware.
And I love the dedication to him in the beginning. Honey, don't take this the wrong way, but this book is dedicated to you for David, my love, which I was like, oh, that's very funny. Because it's about a book about dudes getting raped and being victims, and she dedicates it to a dude. That's just very funny. But then I also liked...
A problematic dude. I mean, I love David Cross, but he's, like, always getting himself into some fucking trouble.
But then I love at the end that there's, like, a last will and testament, and somebody leaves the comedy records, and it's like, Hicks, Pryor, David Cross.
Yeah. Classic. Classic legend, David Cross, among the greats.
I mean, it's not wrong. Like, his comedy albums are amazing, but
Lenny Bruce.
It's literally, like, three of the biggest comedians of all time, and David Cross.
Bill Hicks.
And I was like, oh, that's love.
Sam
like,
Kinison.
David Cross. I love that, though. It was wonderful.
Yeah, it's nice. I mean, also, to be fair, that guy could also be, I mean, he's not from Albuquerque or whatever, but he could be David Cross. David Cross is also a Boston comedian, right? Yeah. So, and also a very angry guy.
I'm scrolling through the things I highlighted on the Kindle version. There was one very early on, that just like, again, this is like the poet in her, I think, that came out, but she tucks the curtains of her long bangs behind her ears and allows grief to take center stage. I'm like, that's flowery, but it's also beautiful.
Yeah, there's also a part where it's like something about like the treble of pebbles on his tongue, something like that, where I'm just like, all right, Amber, move it along.
I liked, so Pear, Marin in this, is a big baseball fan. I'm like, that's not Marin. Like, Marin doesn't give a shit about baseball.
Sure.
But I did like the idea... Like, there's moments of, like, earnest humanity, I feel, where he's like, get me cremated, leave me in a Coca-Cola cup under the bleachers in Fenway.
Yeah.
I'm like, that's a wonderful way to go out. Like, mm-hmm. that's just, I love that. The trash always made me so happy, made me feel like I was in a place where people were really living. That sounds like Marin.
These are details that are added to these men's lives that give them a color and shape that female victims of rape are often denied in the world that we live in. So there's value in that, in showing these men's stories beyond that.
She also does a really effective job of like showing how their lives, like I mentioned before, like they break in different ways, but at one point, like Marin just finds lots of dead birds in his trunk. He opens his trunk and just filled with dead birds.
It's pretty scary.
And it's not explained how that happened.
Yeah. I think the assumption is that Maud is fucking with him. I mean, that was my assumption anyway.
I mean, so I was, you know, in that kind of thing.
I mean, it feels supernatural. Once again,
it does. But it feels, you know, like, have you watched The Leftovers? We've talked, or no?
No, man, that shit is too bleak for me.
It is. But it's my favorite show of all time.
Yeah.
Which maybe says something about me. But at one, you know.
My favorite show of all time is the cartoon The Critic.
So Kevin Garvey, who's the main character played by Justin Theroux, kind of has these, like, episodes where he is maybe dreaming or maybe sleepwalking or maybe actually doing these things and just disassociating.
Or maybe jogging with his wang flopping around.
Big old dick. But he just, like, he's killing deer and dogs. And it's just, like maybe Marin, this Marin character, Pear, is just killing birds and throwing them in the trunk. And then, like, but in, like, a kind of, like, a dissociative, like, fugue state where he, like, is so traumatized, and whether he knows the extent to which or not, like, he thinks he's getting better through these group therapy things, sessions, but he's also filling up his trunk with birds. So I thought either whether it's Maud fucking
also,
with him.
There also might be some traditional dead bird symbolism that I didn't bother to look up or think about.
But I think no matter how, I'm just saying, like, no matter how you break that down, I think it's effective in, like, oh, his, it's worse than it makes him seem.
Yeah, he's been rewired.
Yeah.
As have all these characters. They've been rewired, they have to adjust, they have to live their lives completely differently from how they lived before. Until they don't, right? Because eventually he does get back to being a guy that lives his life like he had been before, basically.
With intent.
Yeah.
I think this also, it shouldn't come as a surprise, like, is a very pro-therapy book. I think that, like, it's value to group therapy and value to, like, expressing yourself and, you know, reporting what happens to you and talking to people about it, whether it's publicly or just privately or whatever. I think there's...
Yeah, he's in a help group, right? Yeah. What is his group? Is it just victims of trauma?
I think
it's,
so.
It's a little bit vague, right? Because it's not for drugs. It's not for... Because Jamar ends up going there too. So it's, I think it's just victims of trauma.
Yeah. It feels like it's exclusively for men in this, right? And just, you know, men who have been through some shit or something, right? So,
are there any female characters in the book other than the women on that The View type show?
The first guy's wife.
Yeah, but does she speak? She doesn't really, right?
I don't think so. Which I think is also effective because, like, when a woman is raped, it's not about the dude. It's about her. It should be about her.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So by, like, if this is... I mean, because it's not like the entire world has been inversed here, right? It's like... It's not like all of a sudden there are tens of thousands of men being raped. It's like there are these four, and there's probably more that are not, almost certainly, that are not reporting it. But it's not like this exists in, like, a upside down universe.
Yeah, it's a statistically identical universe, because when they talk about the statistics, they do talk about it being, you know.
And so I think that it makes sense that if you're inverting the focus for that intent, you would not muddy that by, like, bringing in people. Because if you're trying to be like, hey, listen to the women, it's like, and also listen to what that dude's got to say. It's like, well, I mean, he might have something valuable to say, but, like, let's listen to her first, right? Yeah. So I think that's done with intent and done well.
Yeah. It's interesting.
Yeah. But I don't think there are any other women.
I mean, when there is that thing of the view, and it is the women who are discussing and laughing and all talking over one another, et cetera. It's like reminiscent of political spaces on television when you have all male panels discussing rape or discussing abortion or discussing any number of issues that largely affect women. And it's just like, why do we have 8 guys on TV talking about this thing? Why are there 8 white men talking about Black Lives Matter? What is going on here? Get some people of color on your show.
Right. Any other thoughts about Any Man?
No.
It's a quick read.
It's a quick read. You should do it. You can. I largely resent / despise actors and musicians and stuff who are just like, I'm going to write a novel. Write a novel. But I think in Amber Tamblyn's case, I think she's probably always been a writer.
Yeah.
And is a writer. And I don't know that I've seen her in that much stuff acting, to be honest. I saw her on that one cop show with Bradley Whitford. I don't know that I've seen her in much else, but
your two favorite movies, the Pants movies.
Yeah. Yeah. The Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants.
But it's weird. Oh no, she was on that, like, not True Calling, but, like, she was on, like, a, maybe, like, a Christian-ish. I feel like she.
The one with Eliza Dushku.
No, that's her show.
Well, anyway, it doesn't really matter. Like, my point is that, like, as much as that normally annoys me, it doesn't in this case, because I think, I mean, Amber Tamblyn's legit. She's not like someone who was just, like, in her spare time writing a novel. Like, you get the sense that this is, like, a thing that she tortured herself over and really, like, wrote a book.
Joan of Arcadia.
Yeah, I don't give a shit about that show.
That's what I think. We think of her as an actor because she started as an actor. Like, we first knew about her as an actor.
Well, she's the son, or she's the daughter of Russ Tamblyn, and she was a child actor. But my point is that I think that most of the time it's not legit, and this time it is legit. Not that I'm the arbiter of what's legit.
No, but I agree with you largely. And also, maybe it's different for like singer-songwriters, but like when you're like, yeah, you should read this John Darnielle book, I was just like, all right. And then like his two books are great.
Yeah, I'm John Darnielle is also like, as far as like, he's one of the great lyricists of the last.
That's not, yeah.
Like that's like saying like, oh, Bob Dylan wrote a book, and you're just like, that sounds completely natural because Bob Dylan is like an artist who should not just be penned in by this one thing. The same way that Amber Tamblyn shouldn't be.
Are there other actors who have written good books?
I don't know. I would guess the person that I would guess has an okay book at least is David Duchovny. Because
he's written a bunch of books,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, because Duchovny's history, not that you should need to be an academic type to be,
well, he went to Oxford.
Or that the Ivy League legitimizes you, but he went to Princeton and Harvard as well.
Oh, I thought he went to Oxford.
Maybe in a
TV show?
And maybe in a semester abroad or something like that.
No, I'm saying but Fox he's, Mulder went to Oxford.
Oh, okay.
I'm just being dumb.
Yeah, fair enough. There are some authors.
Well, like, I'm sure like James Franco probably has written a book.
Oh, he did. Yeah, Palo Alto. Yeah.
Is that good? Oh, that's like short stories, right?
Yeah.
That he then adapted, or someone adapted into a movie.
Yeah, I read it. It's whatever.
But it feels like he's like the kind of guy, because there's people like, he's just like, I want to try. He feels like the kind of person like, I want to do everything. And it's like, well, maybe it's good, maybe it's not good.
He wants to be taken very seriously as an artist.
Yeah.
His short story collection is largely a cipher of much better writers. Okay. He's just like sort of plucking influences and sort of doing chameleon, doing impressions of them.
You want to call Matt?
I don't know. Do we? The cover of this book is so like...
He's also watching the... We're putting this in a time and place. He's watching the Olympics opening ceremony with a 7-year-old daughter right now.
Yeah, I don't bother him. You don't think you should bother him?
Well, I'm gonna text it to the thread and just say, what do you guys think of this?
You can text and ask if we can call Matt, because I don't know if we want to bug him if he's watching the Olympics.
USA. USA.
What are you doing? What are you doing? Why'd you yell USA?
Hi, Violet.
Hey, Violet.
Daddy, why did you yell USA?
Here, you're on a podcast with Joey and Bob.
What's doing?
Do you guys like to talk about books?
Violet, you've met us.
What?
You have met them. We had lunch together.
What?
They came and went to Sabrina's, and then Bob gave you a book about 9/11.
And the pop-up book about sharks.
Yeah. We just read that last night, as a matter of fact.
Oh.
But I like the sharks.
Yeah, sharks. She got it in your lap right now, as a matter of fact.
You know, I would actually love to, you know, this is the unprecedented return. We finished recording. Yeah. We're back on the mic now to talk to you. This is the Honorable Judge Matt Erdely and the also presiding Honorable Violet Erdely.
That's right.
Judge a book by its cover. We just texted to the Tub Talk thread. By the way, if you have not listened to Tub Talk yet, go listen to all 11 episodes of that. But here's a cover. I would love to get both of your opinion on what you think of this cover.
All right, here, let's get Violet's opinion on this, too.
I will not tell you what this book's about, though. You know, that's a conversation we're not going to have.
All right, what do you think of that?
It looks pink.
It does look pink. What does it say? Can you read it?
I mean,
It says a novel. Amber Tamblyn is the author, and there's a quote right on the front. It says, an explosive, shape-shifting piece of literary real estate, whatever that means. Tamblyn takes every risk in this astonishing and innovative work and succeeds gloriously. Quote by Janet Fitch, best-selling author of The Revolution of Marina M and Paint It Black. What does that book cover make you feel like?
It makes me feel like...
What does it look like to you?
It looks like steam.
Yeah, it does look like steam.
Pink steam. It looks like there's pink lights behind steam.
Yeah, does it make you feel calm, or does it look like it's maybe like a violent book or like a
violent,
crazy book? You think the person in this book is having a good time, or are they having a scared time, or are they having a fun time? What do you think?
A mean time.
Yeah, you think it's about somebody mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, it definitely is sinister, right?
Yeah.
With the steam, coming out of a... out of like a subway.
Or someone's ears being really mad.
Yeah. Yeah. So our assumption is that the titular man maybe got his hand caught in an oven while a mischievous little mouse ran around his feet.
You're close. That's our
guess. And it could happen to any man. So Matt, make sure that you don't have your hand caught in an oven when the mouse running is running around. Otherwise, Violet will have to save you.
I look at this as this is the story of a lady having a social time out and about in the city, perhaps after midnight, and running through the gauntlet of gentlemen callers.
To me, it looks like someone is mad over something.
Yeah,
it's kind of a combination of both those things.
Mm-hmm.
There you go.
You're both right. Violet, I have a very important question for you. If you were a judge, do you know what a judge is? Like, you know about courtrooms and judges and stuff?
Yeah.
When we have art contests and stuff.
Yeah.
So if you were, like, a judge normally wears, like, a robe. They normally wear, like, a black robe. But if you got to pick any color robe you would get to wear, what color would you want to wear your robe? And do you like the color violet, or do you not like that because it's your name? Do you like it extra because it's your name, or do you not like it because it's your name, or do you have no opinion on it one way or the other?
I don't really care about it.
But okay.
To me, it looks too blue to be purple.
Okay. There you go. Okay.
So, is marigold still your favorite color?
Yes.
So a marigold robe. That's a nice marigold robe. That's a nice looking robe.
There you go.
I love it. What are you looking forward to in the Olympics?
Even though this episode comes out after the Olympics, right?
The gymnastics.
Oh, yeah, me too. That's my favorite, too.
Do you like Simone Biles?
Yeah, she's my favorite.
Yeah, she's great, right?
Hey, Grenada, there you go. So here's a little bit of history. When Judge Matt went on his honeymoon, it was mere weeks after Karani James won Grenada's first ever Olympic gold medal in the 100-meter dash.
Wow.
And that's where you went on your honeymoon, right?
That's where we went, Grenada. Yeah. Grenada. They had a big banner stretched over the road leaving the airport.
And I like the gymnastics the most because I go to a gymnastics camp.
Oh, all right. Cool.
Right on.
There you go. Very cool. Isn't Amber Tamblyn, isn't she married to David Cross?
She is.
So maybe he's the any man.
He could be.
He certainly could be, yeah.
So many people are from different countries. It just keeps going on and on and on.
Most people are from other countries.
Oh, yeah, Violet, by the time this is over, the Olympics, the opening ceremony is over, you're going to have a birthday or two. Like, these are very long. You're going to be like 11 or 12 years old by the time this is over.
No.
Mr. Joey doesn't have any concept of time. All right, Vi, any more thoughts on the on this book cover? Is that look like a book you'd want to read?
When I'm nine.
When you're nine.
Maybe okay. Maybe when you're much older than
mature
nine.
Mature themes. She picks up on the mature themes.
Yeah.
Connotated by the design.
Okay, we'll talk about it again when you're nine.
Thank you.
When the Olympics are over.
Yeah, exactly. But thank you both for joining us on the podcast.
Yeah, say goodbye.
Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye.
See you guys.
All right, later. That will be our most popular segment ever.
Do we want to talk about, like, fantasy casting or anything? Because I feel like it's...
I don't know. Oh, if you're going to make this movie, number one, I don't think it works as a movie because of all of the tweets and all of the...
You maybe could, though.
The mundanity of things.
Like, maybe. You could just Photoshop them and, like, have them on screen. Like, you wouldn't be able to read them. You just have, like a or you have someone literally scrolling through Twitter or something.
Maybe if you presented it like a docudrama and just, like, had it, like, I don't know, maybe it could work like that. But so much of it is, like, journals.
If this was adapted into a movie, do you think, like, Amber Tamblyn would, like, direct it? Like, I feel like maybe not.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know. Your friend Egg wrote an email about this book.
Let's hear from Egg.
We have an email address, lottery or lotterypod at cageclub.me. Either one will get it to us. Meg's reaction to Any Man. At Bobby's suggestion, I ended up listening to the audiobook version.
There you go.
Which you did. I did not. I'm really glad I did. It felt a lot more powerful than I suspect it would have. The scene where all the women are talking and are so dismissive of the serial rapist was so chilling, which you talked about. I'm glad I listened to the book, but I don't know if I could ever bring myself to recommend this to anyone. I could appreciate the novel for successfully swapping typical gender norms, as well as showing different ways the characters reacted to their rapes, but this feels like there's a certain level of, quote, preaching to the choir as a woman reading this book.
Yeah, that's what I said, right?
Yeah.
Look at me.
I think it's this kind of thing where, like, everyone should read it, but also the people who are going to read it probably already know.
Yeah.
And I don't mean that dismissively. It's just that, like you were saying earlier, it would be great to put this out into the world of people, like, who need to know this.
Could I teach this book? What do you think of that? Or do you think that's too much? You think I'd get in trouble teaching it?
I haven't really... I can't pinpoint the things you should or should not or cannot teach.
I mean, neither can I. It's been a problem. You never know who's gonna be angry about something. I'm not one of those people that thinks that, like, this generation's too sensitive or whatever, but I have had random students be really offended by random things, and then they go to my boss and they're like, hey, and then I have to talk to my boss about it.
I think it's the kind of thing that should be taught. Yeah. I think that if you were a man about it, okay, you would talk to your boss about it and be like, hey, I think this should be taught, and, like, preemptively have a conversation. Because I think that, like, but that feels like,
yeah,
that feels like asking for permission rather than forgiveness or whatever, right?
Right. Yeah. Well, I also, I mean, there is another, like, a colleague of mine teaches American Psycho, and I would never teach American Psycho. And I think part of the reason why she can teach American Psycho, there's something about a woman teaching that stuff that is easy. It's easier to communicate with female students, because otherwise it's like a male teacher lecturing about rape. You know, there's something about it that doesn't follow.
That's what's weird. And not weird, but that's what's challenging.
Joey's rubbing his temples and has his eyes closed right now. he's like
Carmack the Great.
Like Professor X.
No, but I think that's what's challenging about this book, is that if a woman teaches it,
yeah,
it's a woman's story, but it's not a woman's story. Like, it's explicitly a man's story to tell the woman's story. Yeah. So a woman teaching it is kind of like, this isn't her story to tell, even though it is her story to tell.
Right.
But then you teaching it, or any man teaching it, is like, well, it's also not your story to tell.
Right.
You would almost need a class that's co-taught by a man and a woman.
Those classes exist.
Yeah, my freshman year, by the end of the year, I was just exhausted of everyone in the class and the teachers. But, like,
I teach at the college that Joey went to.
Oh, this is even the high school, though. I had a year long, we had block scheduling. So every day for a full year for 90 minutes, I was in a class that was English and history combined called Humanities, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was a male teacher and a female teacher. And I think that would be, like, a better kind of environment. That's the only time I've ever had that kind of environment. Because I think you need multiple perspectives on this. More so than the other books in this season so far, possibly, it's a book written to inspire conversation and dialogue. I think there's a imbalanced power dynamic between you having read it a couple times and, like, a bunch of, like, 18-year-olds who have never read it, who don't have a lot of life experience, even though I'm sure some of them, many of them, who knows, have been victims of horrific traumatic events. But you need, I think, not good cop, bad cop, but, like, two sides of things. I don't know.
Yeah. If I were to teach it, I would teach it as the last book of the semester so that I had a long...
So you, like, could run away?
So that I had a long relationship with these students beforehand. Sure. So that they knew who I was and I knew who they were, so that I would know how to approach things.
Because I think, you know, this whole season, once again, the theme of processing pain, the way we've hurt people and how we've been hurt, is heavy. But I think this is much a more sensitive topic than... And again, given all this, but, like, mental illness or, like, obsession or whatever's going on in that dude's head, and you shouldn't lower velocity, just, like, disillusionment, maybe? Parental abuse or something, and then it just... All these are very heavy. What I'm saying is that you've picked very heavy things for us to read.
Yeah.
And this feels heavy and difficult in a different way.
Yeah. We might just do comedy next season. Just comedy books.
Like joke books?
Yeah. like
Uncle John's Bathroom Reader.
Yeah, Kristen's mom has this book that's just like Italian jokes. just like jokes that you can tell about Italian people.
You know, we got Eggers, we got Murakami, we got Tamblyn, we got Uncle John's Italian jokes.
The foreword to that book is like, it's like written in like an Italian voice. It's like, I read this book. It's really funny.
So come back next season for Italian jokes. We still got three more books this season. Duck's Newbery Port by Lucy Ellman, Open City by Teju Cole, and Never Let Me Go by Kazuo Ishiguro.
Was that the entirety of Meg's email? I'm sorry. I feel
yes.
like
we cut yeah, it off. No, it was.
Yeah, something that happens with, because me and Meg talk about these books. So like, I feel like when we're talking about it in text messaging, like, we have the conversations and then I process those conversations and they end up as part of what I say during the episode. And then Meg emails and she's like, here's what I think. And it's just like, I've just stolen all of Meg's thoughts and said them before her email gets here. Maybe we should put her emails at the top of the show. That way I'm not robbing them.
Well, this is the first time that we've done an email segment where I'm like, I don't feel like my job is in jeopardy because everything she said, you've already said. So it's like, you can't take my job because you have your job. Also, like, there's the background of, like, you and I go out to get food before we record most of these, and so we have a conversation.
Yeah.
Although we didn't today. Our conversation today was about the next book.
Yeah.
So maybe that's why this is different? I don't know.
Different.
Patreon.com/lotterypod if you want to join over there. Bonus episodes in between every episode, just about. At lotterypod on Twitter. We got Jean Kyung Fraser to respond to us, which is cool. She knows about us. You're welcome, Jean. lottery at cageclub.me and go to cageclub.me/lottery to check out the Audible thing if you want to get, again, the next one is a very long book. If you want the audiobook, there's an Audible link on our website. Go there, get it for free, cancel if you want, do whatever you got
to
do.
Also, after we read the next book, we are going to have a Zoom meeting where we discuss the
I think even probably while we're doing this, but maybe
We'll have a Zoom meeting where we discuss the upcoming season. If you'd like to take part in that.
Comedy.
Comedy. If you'd like to take part in that, just shoot us an email or donate $1 a month to the Patreon.
I don't think we have a dollar. Do we have a dollar? Is it starts at five?
No, there's the dollar one. The dollar one doesn't get you the extra episodes. It just gets you the participation in the Zoom.
Oh, right. Okay. Cool.
Yeah.
So email us, join the Patreon, and keep reading.
No. No, he struggled to put it in at the end there, like so casually. And by the end of this season, I'm going to get Joey to stop doing that. Yeah.
But keep reading.
Can't prevent. Fuck you. So hard. Today's crime is jaywalking. Many men wish death upon me. Blood in my dog and I can't see. I'm trying to be what I'm destined to be.